Ja, Doe.
Greetings in the mighty and matchless name of our Lord Jesus Christ to another Business House Bible study today, Tuesday, the 4th of May, 2021.
Amen. Hallelujah.
It's a great pleasure and it's a privilege and it's also humbling to be standing here as a husband and wife and as a couple to greet you and to serve you, the people of Fiji, and especially for those that you are committed to Tuesday Business House Bible Study. And while we're still on the date, May the 24th of May 2021, I take this time to say happy birthday to my beautiful
Hallelujah.
Wife here, and that will be joining me to serve you today.
Amen.
With Kingdom Economics.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So I take this time to say once again, thank you for logging in, and thank you for allowing us to serve you this wonderful afternoon.
Yeah, we would like to say greetings to those business house
yes.
that we usually roster people to come and talk to you in your vicinity, in
yes.
the office.
And those business houses are TLTB Suva and Rural and Maritime Suva.
Amen.
Fisheries in Running Water in Lami. And we have agriculture at Thakumbau House in Nosori.
Praise the Lord.
AFL Namaka. And fisheries all the way in Labasa.
Amen.
Not forgetting the three
fire stations,
Nandi, Lotoka, and Suva. And that is in Walu Bay.
So greetings to all of you if you're logging in today.
Hallelujah. And it's so wonderful to say good afternoon as we will talk about Kingdom Economics. Not forgetting the other business house that you are connecting us
yes.
every day from Monday to Friday, and also the senior pastors and church members of NCF or you are out there that you know about this program, Business House Bible Study 1-2, and we take this time to greet you all in the mighty and matchless name of our
Hallelujah.
Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
And maybe you're one of the ones who are not part of any business house or not even a member of the church, but yet you happen to be watching us right now. We also welcome you and we say thank you for taking the time to log in. And today we would like to share the little that we have that can make a difference in your life, or you can take it on
yes.
Yourself and be a learning experience and step up to your financial. And it's called the Kingdom Economics.
Kingdom Economics, yeah. And when we talk about Kingdom Economics, it's talking about operating under Kingdom
Hallelujah.
Principle. And the Kingdom Principle is well known in Matthew chapter 3, verse 33. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God.
Chapter 6,
verse 33. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness.
Hallelujah.
And all these things shall be added to you. He's talking about your food. He's talking about your clothes. And he's talking about what you drink. And most of the time you are so worried. And he said, do not worry and say what to eat, what to drink,
Amen.
And what to wear. So when you have the Kingdom Economics, it will take care of all these things, the basic needs that we worried about every day of our life. And that's why it's very good to talk about the Kingdom Economics. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Especially this time that some of us, we already lost our job. Some of us, we are already on half pay.
Yes.
And maybe some of us, both of us, that we are on a reduced pay. And when you operate under the Kingdom Economics, you got nothing to worry
Hallelujah.
About. Hallelujah. Because you are operating under Kingdom Economics. And it will take care of your food. It will take care of what you drink. And will take care of your clothes or
Hallelujah.
Your shelter.
Yeah.
Because the Bible says that is the characteristic of those that does not have a Heavenly Father. Those are the characteristic of heathen.
So
but for you,
worry.
Yeah. But for you, you have a Heavenly Father.
Hallelujah.
He knows exactly what's good for you. So that's why we need to operate under Kingdom Economics. And Randini will share with us when you operate under Kingdom Economics. And that is a lot of wisdom and knowledge. Not only that you know the Bible, not only that you try to operate just in the Spirit. It also calls on how you manage every day of your life. Eh?
Well, if you have been listening to the on-air program this morning,
yes,
I believe he shared
about
the tithe.
Every Tuesday,
from,
8 to 9.
From Lotoka, a service that we had on the last Sunday. before we start having the lockdown, yes. Yet on the second phase. So if you are an earner or a person who gets a salary at the end of the week or the fortnight or the month, you have your source of funds coming in, you know, from a company or from any other way, but you're receiving money. And in the kingdom economics, Onawan Gasileva has shared with us on the tithe on Malachi 3:10, you will need to give a tenth of that to the denomination you belong to the church that you go to. Maybe some of our churches, when I grew up, my father was actually the Vakatawa of the Lotu Esile, the Methodist Church, you know, Viti and Rutuma. And he was the Vakatawa, and I was, his daughter. Mm-hmm. So when we go to church, we don't hear about the tithe. I don't hear about the tithe or anything about the tithe. But when I grew up, my father, because we own farm, and everything that we do in the farm, or even if it's the first time that we actually, you know, harvesting, like for the year, we won't be able to eat it straight away. He will actually tie the red cloth on everything for us to tell us as a family, don't touch that. And when we have the harvest, whether it's the uvi or the different kind of moly that we planted, or anything else, pineapple, panapini viti, panapini valangi, ikona kila kwa kaya kundo tete. Nabi matagali kake tete, okwenda visuka na, you know, na sulun damundamu, mekabi kito, kwa kaya kito wakasango. If we are cooking and if we are doing something for the family, we are not allowed to take anything that has the red cloth in it. And the thing that he does, when it harvests, a tenth of that, he takes it to, you know, the head of the Methodist church then that was looking after our Tambathaka Thaka. And not only that, and on the Sunday, he will use the same thing. And then I used to remember this, I believe we used it as a basin in Ibulubulu. You know, you wash your hands in the small basin. We will get that. If it's the harvesting of all the lemon and all of everything that we harvest on Dawa or anything, or Kavika, we'll put all in that basin, and it goes to, you know, the elders of the church that we belong to. And he's always, even though it was not taught in the church that we attend, but he lives the life and taught us that kind of living. So growing up, I saw that. And when my father actually passed on, I was only in Form 3, and I was only 13 years old. And I started going to other churches just to, you know, like I couldn't have enough of this God, and I started searching for more. I went to most churches to try and find him the way that I was hungry for, but I couldn't seem to find, you know, that solace that I found him. I can't seem to have the peace in me. So I started going from church to church, not belonging to any, but just sitting there and experiencing, you know, their type presence, of worship. Yeah. And the only two church that I didn't really walk into experience was the Latter-day Saints and the a Catholic Church. Other than that, I've been to all. And I walked into this Assemblies of God Church in Namoli, which is not far from where we live, because we actually lived in Namoli and renting in Namoli. And I walked into this church, and the two Sunday consecutively, they were teaching tithe. And that's the first time for me to hear. When I heard, I was in Form 3, remember. I was only in Form 3. When I heard, I came, and that message convicted me to the core of my heart. It wasn't just a message that you hear, and you say to yourself, okay, you know, there is the knowledge of mine. For me, it was a conviction, and I believe, and I thank God, through His Holy Spirit, in allowing me to be convicted at that moment to do something about it. So I started tithing when I was only in Form 3. A tithe became part of my life. In everything that I do, I give a tithe. Any money that I receive, I give a tithe. Anything. It doesn't have to be my pay or my salary. Anything that I get, I give out the tithe. Until today, I will look through my closet, I look through my shoes, I'll always have to put aside something to give back in whatever way, and not only my salary. Mm. And I could say that I've lived the life of honoring that tithe, and I want to share with you. Because sometimes you reach a stage when you say to yourself, okay, the money that I'm getting, if I have to take out that tithe, that's quite a substantial amount, and it will chew to my balance. Yeah, automatically the devil will play in your mind to do that. Look, you just need to conquer it once, twice. Give yourself a month. Once you conquer, you will say to yourself, okay, I can go and I can do this. Hallelujah. But once you continue to give excuses, because your money will never be enough to match your expense.
Yeah.
Your income is always less because okay, na tamata lomba level. And the winner katana kakenga. You control tiki kenda na kame na kap. And then our pay or the money that's coming in is not sufficient to match that. And that is why you go to the money lender. And that is why you go and kere from everywhere else. Because the life you're living is not matching the income that you're getting.
Hallelujah.
And on another note, if you say to yourself, okay, I have all these payments to pay. Yes, write it down. And look at it in the physical sense. You'll say to yourself, my expense is far greater than my income. Which means your mind will tell you, you can go without giving your tithe because you just can't afford to give your tithe.
Mm.
Because it's telling you that the money doesn't match already. And giving your tithe, two more. Well, the devil will play that in your mind. And I'm sharing this
Hallelujah.
With you because I've been there. I've done that. I've reached a moment like what I'm sharing now. I reached those moments and the deciding factor in my heart was to not to give. And then you'll say to yourself, I'll give it later. Or you'll say, oh, maybe next time or next pay, I will give both the tithe for this week and the tithe for next week. No, tithe doesn't work that way. Tithe has to be given on the week or on the time that you receive.
Amen.
So if it doesn't match priority, give your tithe. Just give your tithe. The rest, somehow it will work itself
because
out.
Because it's God's
yes.
word.
And you can cut a bit on the areas that you can cut. You can cut on a grocery shopping, or you can cut certain things that you used to enjoy. Cut certain things you can go without. Look at the things you can go without. But the the payment of your mortgage that you cannot afford. You have the payment of your bills that you cannot afford. Electricity, the basic things that
yeah.
you need to pay. Those things you do. If anything for you to supplement on the food or on yourself.
Yes.
Because for the food, somebody will come and knock on your door and be the hand that God will send you indirectly to tell you, carry on, you're on the right path, I will help you and I will guide you. And I reached a stage like my expenses was far greater than my income. And what I used to do, I used to cut down on my grocery shopping. And sometimes I can go without it. And the children will come and say, oh, mom, there's no butter. Oh, there's no milk. And said, okay,
Hallelujah.
Pray. Go upstairs and pray.
Hallelujah.
And, it doesn't make sense to them. Indirectly, they can't say it in my face. They want to tell me, hello, you're getting paid. You are our mom. Buy it for us. But I channel my children to God. I channel their needs to God in whatever ways. And if it's there, it's there. If it's not there, it's not there. I've never gone out of my way to go to the money lender. I've never gone out of my way to ask money. I taught myself I'm not going to ask. Even without it, I will never ask. And that is the system that I've lived with until today. Even today, with the things around me and when I am in it, this is my husband. We can go together. I look after the ministry expenses. And I look after my TV. And apart from that, I look after my family. We can be going together and I'm lacking in so many ways. So much funds that I need to pay certain bills. But I will ask him, as we go, I wouldn't even share with him or for me to turn to him and say, you can help me with this. Or, I'm running short on this one here. Or I cannot seem to pay this. I will never tell him. And sometimes he will hear me as I testify because he can be the transport provider or took me to the ATM. And I'll be standing at the ATM machine, punching in my card. And the screen is, highly bold, telling me insufficient fund. And I'll keep on putting it inside. I said, no, Lord, you're going to make it happen. You will make it up. And you will make it up. Yeah, it sounds crazy, but that's how crazy it can be. And until today, I could say, like the joy of knowing that he's always there to look after your lack. So if you're struggling with the fact to give your tithe, that's the first priority that you need to do. If you want to be covered by the kingdom economics, you can't afford not to give your tithe. The church you belong to, give your tithe. You can tell me, raise your hand and say, I'm listening to you and I'm listening to you too, but I don't belong to any denomination. I don't belong to church. You can send it to the place that you get your spiritual feeding, which means if you're listening to us today or you're tuning to us on God of Our Nation or listening to my TV on other programs that comes in from all other churches on my TV platform, then bring it to my TV.
Because
wherever you get your feeding on the spiritual element that feeds you in the spiritual sense, that's where your tithe goes to. Because when you give your tithe, it looks after the administration of the church, and God automatically looks after the administration of your home. Administration in what sense? Your electricity bill, telephone bill if you're on the landline, your food, Those things you're not supposed to be praying to happen. It's supposed to be given. When you give your tithe, that happens. Because you look after the administration of the church. He looks after the administration of your home. The things you pray for is the things above the things that, you know, that is out of the norm. Like you can be praying to buy something on higher purchase or buy a lounge or buy a fridge. Those are the things that is above that you see before God and then you pray before God. And that becomes another city because it becomes the activator. It becomes your offering.
Offering.
It becomes naming or putting a name to the seed that you have given. We have people that come in naming seeds like a good health or a sickness that they need healing. Or they put in a seed to buy their property or to buy their car or buy the piece of land, like what I shared last Sunday, last Tuesday, on the couple all the way from Christchurch. Remember, the lady is a Christian, but the husband is a Hindustani. But yet, he gives his tithe and naming the seed for that land and naming the seed for their business. So, one way or the other, you will need to understand the concept of kingdom economics and go through with it. It will be challenging, but you will need to challenge yourself and rise with it and face it. Because God is going with you. You're not doing it alone. He is actually helping you.
The Bible says, bring your tithe, all your tithe to the storehouse.
Yeah.
So when we're sharing that, you take it to your church, because that is where they store the house.
Yeah.
We are talking about what the Bible says, the word of the Lord. So take your tithe to the storehouse. Now, when it comes to you are not belonging to another church, then where are you listening? Where is the spiritual food coming to you? But you are not belonging to another church. You can be called yourself a church name, but you don't go there. You've never been there. And you are listening, for example, you are listening to my TV, or you are listening to us. If you are listening to my TV, 5 o'clock in the morning, 8 o'clock in the morning, and you are listening to the prayer at 11, so your tithe must go to my TV. Because that is the storehouse. And the Bible says, so there may be food in my house. So the food, spiritual food, will continue to come through the preaching that comes from my TV. See? You are assisting in your receiving. Mm. So,
and that goes for your churches. Yeah, I mean, we're not here to promote my TV to you.
We are not here to promote. Yeah. We are talking about the principle.
Yes.
So if you are listening to our program, then it goes to our program. And you can go to other program. Regardless of your church, you go to your church and you listen to other people. You can take your tithe to your church because you normally go there. So rightfully, your tithe goes to your church. That's why it's very, very important for you to understand the principle of tithe.
Amen.
Because it says, bring all your tithe to the storehouse. And because of your giving or your activator, that's a different thing altogether. We are talking today. The first thing that you must do is tithe. Because I believe for you to cancel what we call poverty and lack, then you need to give your tithe.
Yeah.
Because according to the Bible, then God will speak to the devourer, will stop the devourer, will cancel the devourer. The devourer that eat up the fruits and also the vineyard. See? It eat up the fruit and also the tree. Oh, hallelujah. And the Lord will speak to the devourer, will cancel the devourer, will stop the devourer. Because that's all in the Bible. So we are sharing something that is biblical for us to flourish according to His word. And when you give your tithe, as I was sharing, every Tuesday 8 to 9, just a special teaching on power of giving. So at the moment I'm on tithing, and I already on 8 things that happen to you when you tithe. So there'll be another 4 coming this Sunday. So I want to challenge our life, especially for us that we are working, and maybe you are working but you are from home at the moment.
Yeah.
Because of the restriction that we have. And we are challenging everyone.
Yeah.
If you are struggling with finance, just look through your tithing.
Yeah.
We are talking about Christianity here. We are talking about the God that we serve.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
And also, we are not just talking about finances. We are talking about your time. We are talking about your resources. We are talking
your talents,
about
your
talent, your gift. You can be a singer. You can be a good speaker. You can be, you know, a good visitation, a person, a good sharer that you can go and uplift somebody else. So whatever that God has gifted you and given to you, then you need to give a tenth of that to your God.
Amen.
And it will be through the denomination or
Hallelujah.
The ministry that you belong to. Like what we've shared, if you're listening today and you belong to you know, the Methodist Church, or you belong to All Nation or Assemblies of God or CMF and other denominations out there. And maybe you say to yourself, no, they don't teach us about tithe. And they don't teach us about tithe, like me. When I heard that when I was only 13 years old and I was only in Form 3, even though we were not taught in the church, I just continued to give my tithe. And I was only in Form 3 then, growing up as a young girl. And then since I met my husband, and when I started working, I continued to give my tithe. And we were actually looking after you know, a lot of things, being church elders for the Methodist Church then.
Yeah.
He was actually heading the evangelism. I was a Sunday school teacher, and we also look up the Sunday school teacher in the Tamadakadaka. We were very staunch Methodist church members, which they, you know, they taught us, or you are listening in, I continue to give the tenth. Even though the church doesn't teach it, but I believe it. I believe the word of God that tells me that I must give my tithe. So you can be in the Methodist church. You need to give your tithe. Give it to your church.
Yes.
Give it to the place that has been feeding you with your spiritual, you know, enhancement in your life and spiritual growth to be who you are today. We have a family that has been with us for the last 5 years, I could say, since we started coming in for my TV. This particular family, that I wouldn't mention their name, they belong to another denomination. And they have grown up children. They have gone up, you know, yeah. I've seen their children. They have two boys and one girl. And I've seen one of the boys went on to be the head boy, deputy head boy. And one of them now is in England. And they always send in their tithe.
Right.
They belong to another denomination, and they're always sending in their tithe. And I've never met them. When they started giving that, a few years later, I had this request coming in that they wanted to meet with me. So they came to my office, and when we actually conversed, they said, we belong to another denomination. And I said, you should give your tithe there. And then they said, no, this is where we feed from. We always hear and being encouraged by the word of God shared from ITV. And we thought it's only befitting that we bring here.
Hallelujah.
And every time that we bring our tithe here, we always write a note and our list. And those three seems to be happening. And, you know, it's happening. And now their son is in England as a British Army. And they both work. And that's not only one. We have about 18 families that actually give in their tithe to MyTV. And you always get a receipt when you walk into MyTV office and see one of the ladies that is in attending. And as you're listening today, you may be one of those people. And not only within Fiji, we have foreigners outside Fiji that send in their sitting or their tithe.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's always what they always say is that we always listen to MyTV and we get our spiritual feeding from there that has helped us. We hear and listen to the teaching that has directed us. And not only that, I shared, I think, a bit last week. We had a lawyer that actually just caught a taxi all the way to my office. And she said, I've been listening to Gasileva's teaching. I don't belong to any denomination. I don't actually attend any church.
Yeah.
But my children does. And then she said, I just felt led by listening to the teaching and listening to Gasileva. And he mentioned that he gives $200 every week for his tithe. And then that challenges me. And I'm a lawyer. And I said, I want to bring my tithe. So we receipted her.
Hallelujah.
And just over the weekend, during the lockdown, she texted and then she said, can I have the ministry account that I can do a direct transfer on my tithe. Look, she doesn't belong to any denomination, but she's listening to all the teaching.
Yeah.
She's applying it in her life. She's not a normal church goer, but she believed in the teaching. She believed in the principle. And then you may be sitting in the same category as her, that you don't belong to any denomination. But if you belong to a denomination and you're actually getting your feeling and your spiritual enhancement from that denomination, you rightfully must give your tithe to them, because your blessing comes from the storehouse, where you are being fed in the spiritual. And when you give in the physical, he also provides the physical elements of the administration of your house.
Hallelujah.
So if you haven't been tithe, and I believe, okay, like weekend on a lot on a one ago, let me get a sense of the tithe. Vale weekend on a lot of petty combat at the Kenda, Wuli, the Nandunicatini. A lot of people, a lot of things you can hear, some teaching that they try to cancel the tithe. And they always say, oh, the tithe is only for the church, or the tithe is only for the pastor, or the tithe. No, you know, like what we always share. When we start this ministry, no, the church never financed anything in our life.
Yeah.
We were well off, and we can say that we can look after ourselves.
Yes.
We don't need other people's money to live on. We actually worked, and we, you know, we were...
We earned.
And we have our home, we have purchased our cars and everything. We actually live without the church. Even when we started the church, all my pay look after the church. And all my money and everything coming in as the only source then when he went on full time was actually running the church. Now, I can say about how many years back? About 6-7 years back? That the church begin to come and give their tithe only once in a month. For the new Methodists, they give, we call it the Mission Sunday. So that Mission Sunday, they give their tithe to their zone or their worship center or wherever they go in. And then they give that giving that we call the Mission Sunday on that one Sunday in a month that is being sent to headquarters for the ministry to run with. All the other giving that they do for the other remaining Sundays, that goes to their worship center, managed by their own pastor and managed by their own senior pastor. But for the church itself, it's the headquarters for the ministry where I administer only once in the whole month, then their finances come. Like for yesterday, we were actually presenting on our leadership training. On Sunday, on the first Sunday, we have the Western Division. So the whole churches in the whole Western Division, we call it the Mission Sunday. So their earning or whatever that they give on that particular Sunday all come into headquarters. And amazingly enough, with all the lockdown, you know, and all its restrictions, not
Thank
meeting
you.
In church, not serving God in the worship center mode,
yes.
Basically in their own home. Because they know that they're giving, you know, activate their receiving. Presenting yesterday, it was like, if you look at it, you will think, okay, they actually have normal church service. No, we didn't have any church service. We had home service through virtual.
Family service.
And they still give their Mission Sunday. And this Sunday, it's the central. So the whole zones, the whole central division, whatever giving that they give in, that comes into headquarters. And every Sunday, there is a region or division that is giving. And only once in the whole month, that giving comes to headquarters that I use or we use to manage and run the church. So, back to you. If you belong to a church that you know you go to and you must attend, don't just give your tithe and then you say to yourself, it's going to work. No, you need to be part of your denomination. You need to become more active. Kingdom economics. But let the kingdom economics. You're going to sell a tithe. And then you work towards that. And that goes back to the new Methodists. Every now and then we are always teaching you. You must have the spirit of the ministry. Know our heart. Know the heart of service. Know the heart out there to service the Fiji and to give and to look out for, you know, for others. So back to the kingdom economics. It's so amazing when you actually come under the umbrella and knowing that God is actually managing your finances. You know, you will never lack. Even the sweetness about kingdom economics,
Yeah, in the kingdom economics is in indo na malo tawa.
Hallelujah.
Sin indo na malo lala. Malo ke denga
tawa. Tawa.
Hallelujah. You don't look, you don't even know that it is the
your
salary is already in the bank because you trust in God. You are not trusting in your salary.
Yeah.
You are trusting in
Hallelujah.
God. And if we can go back to the last Sunday giving, and I was sharing, the giving is not because you come to church. The giving is because you're serving God.
Hallelujah.
So whether you serve God as a family, or you serve God individually, or you serve God wherever you are, you're watching on right now, you don't give because you are in the church. No, that is religion. That is religiosity.
Hallelujah.
When you have a relationship, regardless where you are, you will give your tithe. Hallelujah. You will give your giving because you want to bless God. You want to bless His church. You want to bless His people. And the giving is not, you're not giving because of the church to run. You're not giving because of the pastor to receive money. No, you're giving because of you.
Hallelujah.
It is for your benefit. Because that's what the Bible says. The Lord said in Malachi chapter 3, why you have turned away from me? Why you have departed from me? Not only turned away, you departed from me. You are facing a different direction and you are also far away. Why you are going that way? Come back to me. How do you come back? He said, by giving your tithe. So it is a challenge. Giving is not only because of the money.
Yeah.
It's because of your relationship. You honor God with your tithe.
Yeah.
When you give your tithe, it's a sign that you honor God. You honor Him as your creator. He is the source of everything.
Hallelujah.
He's the source of your talent if you are a rugby player. He's the source of your intellect and your intelligence. He's the source of your singing,
yeah.
If your talent, if you're a singer. And he's the source of if you're Lulu Nyavusa, Lulu Matangali,
Amen.
That you own the fishing ground and all this land.
Yeah.
He is the source of it all.
Hallelujah.
So your giving is nothing to do with the church and running. No, it's got to do with your relationship with God.
Hallelujah.
When I talk about honor, you honor God by giving your tithe. That is the first thing. When you give your tithe, you're just honoring God. When I decide, I think it was about September or around about 2013 that I decided to give $200 every Sunday. If I go overseas, if I don't give it there, I'll give it in Fiji. Hallelujah. And $200, just because I just want to honor God for the things that He already done in my life, as our relationship, as my family, my children, and also the ministry. I just want to honor Him. Hallelujah. God just love you, and it's a unmerited thing that you don't need to explain. That you just love God, you want to give to God. The more you want to give to God, and that is the heart of God. When you have the heart of giving, remember that is the heart of God.
Yeah.
Because when in John chapter 3 verse 16, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that He gave."
Hallelujah.
It was the love connected to the giving. You cannot say that you love unless you give. You only give because of your love. That's why sometimes they turn away. Oh, it's about tithe. It's about money. No, it's not about money. It's about relationship. It's
yes.
about honoring. And now today, because we come and work and then we talk about money. But in the olden days, those that they look after the farm, those that look after the crops, those they go fishing, those are the very things that you live on. And those are the things that you tithe to God. But now because we come and work and we receive salary, we don't have a farm, we don't go and plant cassava anymore. We go and buy the cassava from the market because we have the money. So we turn to money just because of the time that we are in.
Yes.
It doesn't mean that you are in the village that you look for money because of your time. No, the little thing.
Yeah, your farm.
Your farm.
We have a couple all the way in England. They live in England, but they have a farm in Taveuni. And every time they send their tithe, and the tithe is always a big sack, 50 kg sack of nalo. And they send it all the way from Taveuni, but they live in England. And they send their tithe all the way to headquarters in Lothala. So it's that thinking, concept.
Kingdom.
Whatever that you own, give a tenth of it to honor
yes,
God.
To honor God.
And even the Lotto Westerle,
yeah.
Every now and then we will be met with a big a basket Ubi. Of yam, na uvi, tamani. Tolo tolo ni ubi lilevu. angebitu na message verto na skirto na tona tukuna na ndene katine e komai na isebu e komai verto na lotu wesele, you know, and it's such a joy. And even then we have a few, and if you're listening in today in Cunningham, erto levida erto sexana ni leveling lotu ni new Methodist and a koene na vesu vesu mbele and a koene na come court. Era lembita tu kani e lozala, mer tu kani tu kana non rendune kati ni sene sevo ni non rete. So ke ba kai ko tu kana lo menita oni ko sene ni vaka vaka, ba ti ko te tu kana sana kai na sene ni nomo vale. Na da vanga na kati ke kya ko to vela lo tal tal, ero ni e no, e ko da rembe kani ko na kai, oh they don't really need this, you know, they're well off or they can afford that. No, it's not about them needing it. It's about you having to do it. Ano ka ba kale we ke to manda kana ni Methodist, I always tell them, look, when you give or not give, it's not going to affect the ministry. Because this ministry, with your giving or without your giving, it will always run and survive. Because we believe in this God.
Hallelujah.
And no, he is God. And he can do anything. He can even send, and I always tell them, he can even send a dog to come and call my name and open their mouth and have an envelope in his mouth. Just, you know, for the benefit of his kingdom. And I believe that. Hallelujah. I believe that he can do anything. But you need to do it to be blessed. And I always challenge them, it's not that you need to give to make it work, or you need to give for the ministry to run. No, you need to give not to benefit the ministry, to benefit you, and not to benefit anybody else, but just to benefit you. Because as you give, God is not going to bless somebody else. God will actually bless you.
Exactly.
So your 1/10 coming, your 9/10, you'll be amazed. He will increase it to be above the 100%. That little money that you have to be able to look after all the other things that you have. And it's amazing on how he works. Well, with the tithe on the side, that just by giving your tithe to God, he will give you wisdom. Wisdom to manage. Because sometimes you will say to yourself, why, I've got a
you
lot of money.
I
have to amount. But I can, you know, this, like, your living, your home, your car has nothing
that's
to show
effect, yeah.
For the money that you are earning. So eleven ago na kendi sao iluti tiko na tanga tarvivila sega na botona. But nuwane ko suliki na nandoni katini o ko suliki ko na alamato. He gives you the wisdom. To manage the 9/10 you have, and it's amazing. I'm speaking from experience. It's just amazing what he does and what he can always do. He gives you that wisdom, the wisdom to manage. That's another story, another training on its own, another sharing on its own.
Mm-hmm.
Like what I said, all of us, with the money that we get, you can say, I've earned enough. I don't really need to listen to this teaching. I've earned enough, and this money is sufficient for me. And I've got, I'm earning more than enough, you know, like a hefty amount that you always receive. But just stand still and do this. Because not only a tithe helps things to come back and be blessed, no, it helps the salvation of your family. Those who haven't given their life to God, just by you honoring God with your tithe, way or the other, your children or your husband will come and serve God too.
Amen.
And not only that, if you have sickness in the house, by giving your tithe and honoring God, he's going to look after the administration for your home and heal the sickness in your house. So there's a lot of, it's not just giving the tithe for the blessing. And if you're saying to yourself, no, I don't really need that blessing because I'm good. Well, if you don't really need a blessing, what about the salvation of your family? What about the sickness that you go through? What about the other things that is pending? What about the relationship that you have with your husband? How close are you? What about the rebellious children that you have in your home?
Mm-hmm.
Are those other things, just by giving your tithe, God fixes your home.
Hallelujah.
He actually, you know, physically fixes your house. And I'm speaking from experience. And as you're listening in also today, then you will need, I'll take you down, which I want to highlight with us today, on how you do your shopping. I try, like I mentioned it a bit last Tuesday, I try and do bulk buying. Maybe you raise your hand, you'll tell me, oh, Auntie Rai, the money that I'm receiving a week, or the money that I'm earning in a fortnight, I cannot afford to do that bulk buying. Well, you write your list, you're manageable. At least 5 kg instead of the 1 kg. Go up a bit. 5 kg rice, 5 kg sugar, and then you buy the container, label them. I forgot to bring that picture, which I will try and show next Tuesday, because that's how we do it, do things at home from that time until today. And some of the homes that I'm coming into to help, and also, you know, just lending hand, I'm implementing that. I'm actually doing the containers for them. I'm labeling it ready for them. And when you do that and you have that bulk buying of 5 kg, you come and put it in there. Then you have the small ones that actually say tea bags. Yeah, I know, you know, you say, okay, it's not a kindergarten school or it's not a school to be labeled. But when it's so well organized, it's amazing on how God go out of his way to fill up those containers. You just need to provide the containers and label them. Just to neatly stack them. You have small bottles, your canister jars for tea bags, sugar, powdered milk, your containers, rice, sugar, flour. And have another container for your dal. Have another container for your oatmeal or for your porridge. Have those labeled. And when it's labeled, then you do bulk buying. And like what I said, according to the strength of your earning, that's how you go bulk. You can go 5 kg, you can go 4 kg, or you can even go 10 kg. And when you do that, then you fill up those containers. When you buy a 10 kg or 5 kg to use over the days and over the weeks, it lasts. Then compare if you're buying 1 kg a day. Not only it's more expensive, it's waste. Because the leftover from here, you don't keep it for the next one. You buy another one. But when you keep it all together in the container, even right to the last grain of rice, you will still use the rice. Yesterday we were cooking, and then my daughter-in-law said, oh, we've run out of rice. He said, just check the other container. So when they check the other container, we actually have to pour out every grain of rice matters. And that's what we cook. So when you keep them in bulk and you buy them in bulk, every grain is well used. Every grain of sugar is well used. Every elements of flour is well used. And when you buy the salad oil, don't buy the small bottle, because after two or three cooking, that finishes. But you buy, there's another size up of 750 milliliters, and there's another size of 4 liters, which is the biggest, or 4.5 liters or 5 liters. If you look at that, the price varies in shop.
Yeah.
We have some for $30 in some shop. We have, if you go to Nance, quite cheap for $12. If you go to Extra, they're sitting on $14, some on $15. So for me, in comparing the price, I will know what to buy from this shop, what to buy from that shop. And you get those liters. And when you get those liters and you use it, you know, it takes you for nearly 2 to 3 weeks, depending on the volume of cooking that you do. It can even take you for a month, just for 1 gallon. And if you calculate the cost of that gallon, say if you calculate it for $13, and you take it down to the small bottles of about $3 plus for one, that will not last you for the whole month. You will have about 4 or 5 or 6 of that small bottles compared to this one bottle that costs you only $12 to $13. So bulk buying, it saves your money. It may be a big spend now, but it saves your money. It's like a small spend every day, but it chews into your money. Like a flour of $6.50 of 10 kg. If you buy 1 kg every day at about 70, 80 cents or dollar something, that's costly. By the time you reach your 10 kg, of 1 kg each, it's about $10 plus. But if you buy 10 kg one go, it's $6.50. Compare either Puncha or FMF, whichever is cheaper. So you go for that cheaper one. And that's how you do your ration. And, you know, it's amazing. When you do that, try and start to do that. Once you do it, on how God will look at you and say, okay, they're giving their tithe. They're honoring me with their, you know, their source. And they even exercise wisdom in managing the things that I bless them with. So even with the 9/10, you still have the wisdom to acknowledge God indirectly. You're living your life, but you're trying to tell God, I'm grateful and thank you. I will manage well what you have given me. I'm so grateful. So when you manage well what God has given you, you are, it's the unspoken word, the unspoken sentence. You are indirectly telling him, I'm so grateful and make sure I will look after it well. And my family knows me at home. Even if we have mission food come in and there's leftover cassava, I'm not going to throw away the cassava. It's like I'm going to fry it or dip it in batter, have it for monitor at my TV, or I'm going to separate it and redo and fry the egg, pack it again, take it to the homeless. And yesterday we came by, we saw a group of, you know, wet, and they were just wrenched with wetness on the road because of the heavy rain yesterday, working on, you know, fixing the cable. Came in the morning, saw them, came again, and then in the afternoon we went home, and we came back again for the leaders' regional training, and last night we saw them again. And the Holy Spirit kept on burning me, you know, like, to look at them on how they were working so hard, and then yet so cold, and they're so wet, wearing their overalls. So I call and ask the Tanga Sisor to search for a place and get a pack of about 25 packs and take it to them. When he came back and relayed the story, it's so enriching, so humbling for him to mention, to say, until I, the look on their face, their gratitude, when they're so soaking wet and tired, and just to receive, you know, that meal. So at home, you may be having a lot of leftovers. Don't throw them away. There is a mouth out there that you can feed. And that goes together with your tithe. So when you do your tithe and you manage this well, it's amazing. I just want to share with us the testimony. And I believe we still have time. Yeah, I think we do. And last week, we were actually talking about it on our finance, because we actually administer paying for the bills. And I was telling my daughter, who actually who is the executive manager pro events and finance. So I came and I was sharing with her, and I said, look, this and that and that. So I told both the EMOps and EM Pro Events, because they are the biggest spender division for the ministry in terms of our fleet and the events and the welfare inclusive of the project. So I turned to them and I said, look, I scale back, I hold back on some of the expenses because of the finances. Money is not there, and I want us to hold back on certain expenses that we have. And I came out of my office and I was talking to her and I said, okay, can you continue with this project, that and that and that. So she looked at me and she said, okay, that's fine. Do we have the money? And that's the question that lingers. She asked me, do we have the money? I looked at her and I said, no, we don't have the money, but just continue with the project. Just do the project, get the quotation, get it rolling, money will come. And soon after speaking with her, I walked towards the washroom. When I was inside the washroom, I heard this cluttering sound. It's the sound was like something that fell on the tile and sort of like, you know, it didn't break, but that sound that really gets your attention. So I came out and I walked out to the security. The only things that I can remember was the two op staff. One is doing the temperature gun and the other one is doing the recording of the name of people that are coming in. So I thought maybe they dropped something or maybe something happened. So when I actually looked out, I saw the two of them and then another person. So I said, okay, what's happening? Are you waiting for somebody? And said, I'm waiting. I said, okay, you go. And you two, what are you two doing? So they look up and said, one is doing the temperature gun and I'm doing the recording. And said, okay, said. But when I stood at the top of the staircase and on the corner of my right eye, on the lounge, I saw a lady sitting there. So I turned and said, oh, praise the Lord, amen. Then Mbula Vinaka. I just say Mbula and I turned and I went. So when I turned to go, and then one of the staff turned, you know, I didn't see her, but she was standing there. She looked at her and she said, oh, Auntie Ryan, she would like to speak to you. And I said, okay. So I came back and saw this lady. When I actually met her, if you're logging in today, Auntie Sandy, thank you. When it's the first time for me to see her, she was actually sitting. And she was just shaking and crying. And I assumed maybe she needed prayer. So I just stood beside her and continued to hold her. And I said, you need prayers. And she kept on apologizing. She kept on saying, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Randini, I'm sorry. And I said, you don't need to apologize. It's okay. She was just shaking. And after she finished crying, and I looked at her and I said, no, what is it? And then she said, she actually had two brown envelopes on her hand. And then she said, I couldn't believe that I'm meeting you, physically meeting you. I've been coming here for years. And she mentioned a few stuff that she knows. And she said, every time I come, I couldn't get to see you because you're always busy. And every time I always plan. Okay. And she said, you may not know me, but I know you. And she said, I wanted to organize your Afghan's biscuit. I want to organize your cheesecake. Like she was talking to me about the things that I like, the things about my life. And I'm actually talking to a complete stranger that I've just met for the very first time. And she went on and she said, and this morning I came and I went straight to the bank. And she said, look at how I'm close. I'm so sorry. And I said, you don't need to apologize. You look okay and that's okay. And she said, everything that I planned to be the first meeting that I've got to have with you didn't work today. I was actually standing at the bank and I heard this voice just to come and see you. And then it tells me that I'm going to meet you today. And here I am and I'm sitting here. And I said, I was in the washroom and I heard this clattering sound. And she said, when I'm sitting here and I heard you talking, and I said to myself, no, I didn't hear that noise. I was sitting right here and I didn't hear anything. And I said, oh, I believe maybe there was God's way to get my attention, because without me coming this way, I wouldn't have met you. But anyway, you are here and, you know, we can continue. If you want prayers, we can pray. And she turned to me and she said, I was standing at the bank today, and then the Lord commanded me to come here. And I just came straight from the bank to come here because I couldn't go out to do anything else unless I come here first. And she said, this is the envelope I want to give to you for you to help you with the ministry. And I look at her and I say, you know, if only you have heard what I've just spoken to my daughter. Because she turned and she said, do we have the money? And I know fully well, because of the current situation we're in Fiji, I'm not going to be relying on anything coming in. But I believe that He's going to make it happen. But how, I don't know. And I want to thank you for hearing the Holy Spirit well. And then she said, this is $14,000 to help you. And she took the other envelope and she said, she looked at me and she said, this is for you and Gaselevo's coffee. And if you can share it with Gaselevo for you too. And we prayed. And then she continued to say, you'll never know how much you've blessed my heart with your teaching. You'll never know how much I've been really blessed of following your teaching. She looked at me and then she said, I'm 55. And she mentioned, she went like this, I only wish that I have heard in the early days of my life for me to change, to follow the teaching earlier than now.
Hallelujah.
And I looked at her and I said, you know, better late than never. At least you have these years to listen. So that goes back to you. If you're hearing this teaching and you say to yourself that you are a young couple, or you are maybe, you know, if you're listening today and you're not married.
Yes.
Everyone.
Everybody.
A single boy or single female or single male, it applies to you. It's, you know, more powerful. But then you can come and go,
it's amazing.
You know, transmission. I'm going to help you in your saving. I don't want you to get married and then start buying these things. I want you to be working. And you're not getting as much, but don't look at your salary. You believe and continue to believe. Because you can get a car while still working and being young, not married. No, the life is there right in front of you. Well, back to what I was sharing. And I went in, and after we spoke, I went in, called my daughter, and I said, you know, can you remember the conversation we've had before I went out? And she said, yeah. And then I showed her the two envelopes. I said, this is just amazing. Even before the conversation happened, God knew and commanded somebody already lining up at the bank. You know, when she mentioned, I'm not even ready, the way I'm dressed. Even that morning, she wasn't dressed to tell herself, okay, I'm going out. You know, I'm going to go to town or I'm going to go to the city. And even in the midst of it all, before the 56 hours lockdown, not everything was open. It was only the essentials, and the bank was one of the essentials. So the moment that she was not ready, indirectly, I believe God was commanding. God was doing all that. So I called my daughter and I opened the other envelope that was meant for me and him. When I opened the envelope and I was relaying the story to her, and I told her, look at that. She gave this for me and Gaselevo. And inside had $4,000. So I look at my children, I call them, and I say, because you always help us with the work of God that takes away the worries, the pressure, and all other things. You come in and help with the things of God, then we will share this.
Hallelujah.
And back to you. You know, it's when you actually work and give your tithe and wisdom and manage it well, every morsel of food, it matters. Because every morsel, it's so appreciated and it's like a blessing to the person who doesn't have any. We were driving through Turek last night to come and take part here. And, just looking out, we always have like a little tribe up our street, of the street people, they're always there. Everything that we have at home, everything that is, channeled across the leftover food prepared or from my TV, if the cakes come in and the miracles that, do happen, hosts don't come, or something happened to the program, that cake goes to the street. That prepacks go to the street. So when we left to go home last night, when I arrived home after the regional, I see these cartons of prepack for the zone that cater for the mission. Thank you. Because the food that you brought last night was enough, more than enough for the mission. It also fed the My TV staff in the night. And not only that, we had an extra 6 to 8 prepack that we delivered to the street. And I take this time to say thank you. That every prepack and every food, it matters. So I'll give this time to Gaselevo to round up as we come towards the end of our time.
Because it's a word of God, the tithe is a word of God. It will be the word of God.
Hallelujah.
And always be the word of God.
Amen.
So she's talking about the management or the wisdom. that God will look after the 9/10 just because you're honoring the 1/10.
Amen.
See, God is not looking for your money. God does not need your money. Mm. Hallelujah. God is looking for your obedience. The Bible says obedience is better than sacrifice. You're going to church, you're committing yourself to church, and you don't give your tithe. No. According to his word, obedience is better than sacrifice. So when you give your tithe, I tell you, you are closing the door from poverty and lack to enter. No, a lot of people, they point fingers, they slander, they bicker because of who we are. We can't help it because we follow his word. And the blessings and the glory of God, the favor of God, the anointing of God will always be on you. So we are encouraging you, regardless of your denomination, give your tithe to your church. You will see. Normally, I challenge people, within 2 months, you will start to realize.
Hallelujah.
Within 2 months, you will start to experience what we experience. Maybe in a different level, but the word of God is the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Every Tuesday, 1 to 2, we'll talk about kingdom economics. We're just on the service, just on the introduction. Because to us, we can't go into the kingdom economics. First, we must talk about his economy, and that is the tithe.
Yeah, so ke bakai ko bakaro ta tuma bi korokoro na no mana no mite. Adabo ke bakai dona ke ni dona ke tini ko tuma baka ta ni lotu se na dona sob sob lotu ko tiko en lo mani no mite ko tiko.
Hallelujah. Yeah. So we thank you, and we normally we give 5 minutes before 2 o'clock for people to go back to their office, and before we say bye from here, we will pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for your word and the sharing that is being uttered from this platform. We thank you, Father God, that your word. That's why you tell the devil, man does not live on bread alone. Oh, in our work, in our talent, in our gift, in our knowledge, and how smart we are. Every person, they live according to the word that proceedeth from God's mouth. And we thank you for the sharing today. It's a blessing to the people that are watching.
Hallelujah.
We release your blessing. We release your anointing. We release your miracle. We release your healing, the abundance, the overflow in your bosom. And we thank you, Father God, for the 1 to 2 program from Monday to Friday. We give you the glory and the honor and the praises. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. And everyone say,
amen and amen.
Thank you for watching Tuesday.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Kingdom Economics. Yeah, we'll meet again next Tuesday. But if you continue to tune in, 1 to 2 tomorrow, I will talk about kingdom
living.
Hallelujah. Till tomorrow, from the studio here in Turek, on behalf of my wife and the church, New Methodist Christian Fellowship, we say, have a blessed afternoon.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Amen.